Welcome to First Reformed United Church of Christ here in the city of Lancaster, Pennsylvania. My name is Pastor D, and I have the awesome privilege of being the pastor here. And we are an open and affirming church, meaning whoever you are and wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcomed and loved and affirmed here at First Reformed Church. Good morning to all of our members and friends that are watching online. Good morning to you. So glad that you joined us today. Today is the first Sunday of Lent, and do we have any announcements? Yes, ma'am. Hold on. They're covered with the mic.
No, she has to do it. I'm doing it. I'm only doing one. First Friday is this Friday. According to the bulletin, we are Forward March. An extravaganza of marches for the organ. It starts at 8. Hope to see as many of you here.
First Friday, organ recital, marching forward. Make sure to forgive us of our sins. Let us say our confession together.
Holy One, we do not always face temptation well. We settle for loaves of bread when our souls long for bread that does not perish. We put you to test, seeking signs of your favor, when you should be still and rest in the knowledge that you are God. We place our trust in leaders who make promises they cannot deliver, when you should be putting our faith in you. Forgive us, O God. Help us to become worthy of your calling. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. This is our prayer. Amen.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Because God's speaking to you all the time. But we need to really listen and focus to know what is being said to us. We lead busy lives and we run from place to place, doing thing to thing. The media tells us what we should do and how we should run our lives and what we should believe. So this Lent, we are going to have what's called an appointment with God each Sunday. And the appointment with God consists of five stations around the church. In each of the four corners, and then there's one in the center in the back. And each one has a little sign at it and tells you what you should do for that station. We're going to give you 5 minutes during each service during Lent to take turns to go. I mean, you can go to all of them in the 5 minutes. You can pick one a week, whatever works for you. And there are chairs at each station for people that they need to sit down. There are kneelers, depending where it is. Our cave over here has chairs that you sit and you meditate. So I'm going to give you a quick rundown of each space before we start, so that you get an idea of what you're looking for. So the first one, we're going to start on this side, is the cave, which everybody's noticed the most. There are chairs in there, and it's a place to meditate. It just is to be still and know that God is there. The second one is back in that corner. That is a place where you're going to light a candle for any intention, for you or for someone else. The one in the middle in the back is for clarity. So if there's something you're worrying about, if there's something you're not sure about, if there's something in your life that you need clarity with, you bring the child for clarity. The one back in this corner is about letting go. If there's something that's holding you back from doing what you think God wants you to do in your life, write it down on the paper and put it into cold blue water, and it will disappear. This corner over here is more like newsprint, writing on newsprint. So anything, any prayer, any worries that you have, you can take a pen and you can write it anywhere on the newsprint. If it's something more private, I have a little cup with rolled paper in it. You can write your concern on there and put it in the, stick it in the rocks or on that black shutter. Those things that you're concerned about, those will be prayed over this whole next week, and that's what will happen each week through Lent. So if you have any questions about that, you can ask me, but we're going to start today, and some people may want to just sit in their pews and meditate for a while. Whatever you would like to do is all open. And these stations you can come to before church or after worship, if you'd like to. So we're going to start each one of these sessions, these appointments with God, with this rain, with the sound of the rain stick. So when you hear that, that's when you know that you may get up from your pew and go to any of the stations. And then there'll be 5 minutes. And then when you hear this again, it'll be time to go back to your pews. Okay? Go ahead. It's time for your appointment with God. Thank you.
Larry Tony.
Thank you. Scripture reading this morning, Psalm 32, the joy of forgiveness. Happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Happy are those to whom the Lord imputes no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. While I kept silent, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all who are faithful offer prayer to you. At the time of distress, the rush of mighty waters shall not reach them. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with glad cries of deliverance. I will instruct and teach you the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Do not be like a horse or a mule without understanding, whose temper must be curbed with bit and bridle, else it will not stay near you. Many are the torments of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds those who trust in the Lord. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. Matthew 4, 1 to 11, the testing of Jesus. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tested by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterward he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, if you are the Son of God, command those stones to become loaves of bread. But he answered, it is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. Jesus said to him, again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. Then Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
God, I pray that they not see Devin, but that they see you. And that they not hear Devin, but that they hear you. Thank you even now, God, that our eyes are anointed to see, our ears are anointed to hear, and our hearts are anointed to understand. And we thank you that our lives today will be made better as a result of the word we hear today. It's in the precious, permanent, powerful name of Jesus Christ. And the people of God say amen.
Amen.
As God said, God, in the time I have to share, I want to put a tag on the verses that Tony read this morning. And I was trying to decide what I wanted to title this message. And I have to, first of all, give Teresa credit because the themes that we have for the next few Sundays of Lent were given by her and incorporate the appointments that we have with God. So I was trying to decide whether to call it giving up, or call it don't give up, or call give up, giving up. But regardless of whichever title you want to use, I'm going to preach for the next few moments about not giving up. By way of introduction, our country has experienced so many things in the beginning of the year. I mean, if we were to be honest, 2023 came in like a wrecking ball. We have climate catastrophe where California is receiving snow and the desert is receiving rain. We have from all coast to coast earthquakes, hurricanes, and climate change all around. On Thursday, I had my sunroof open because it was 75 degrees in February. Every week, someone loses their life to violence, to gun violence. And after you work a job for years and years, they tell you that they have to downsize and now give you a pink slip. They give you a severance package, but then you still have to decide, what am I to do with my life? Your partner cheated on you. The diagnosis was not what you were expecting. You just buried a loved one, and now you're planning a loved one's memorial. Your friends have turned enemy. The investment didn't go in your favor. They gave the job to someone else. All a valid reason is for us to give up. All a valid reasons, Judy, for us to throw in the towel. All a valid reasons for us to call it quits. But the good news is this, that you can give up. In other words, would you just indulge me for a moment and look at your neighbor beside you and say, neighbor,
don't give up.
That's right. I know you want to. I know you have every right to. I know you feel as though you can. But don't give up. Because, Dean Loveless, I am of the persuasion that if I still have a pulse, I still have a purpose. Who am I talking to in this church? I said, if I still have a pulse, I still have a purpose. In other words, hold your wrist out if you will. Take your two fingers and put it there. You feel that? You still got a pulse. You still have a purpose. And even though you have every reason, Joan, to throw in the towel, even though you have every reason, Chris, to call it quits, I stopped by this morning, crossing over the courtyard to tell somebody, don't give up. Well, come up close and look at the text. I feel like preaching, y'all. The text shows us this morning the story of Jesus' journey, Dina, in the desert. And if we were to be real this morning, Dr. Malaysia, we would have to admit that our story is also this story. Yes, we may never hear the devil's voice in our ears. We may never find ourselves alone in a Judean wilderness. But from the moment we get up in the morning until we close our eyes at night, we deal with temptation. We deal with choices. We deal with the option of whether or not we want to give up. And the good news is that you don't have to give up. Here it is, at the very beginning of Jesus' public ministry. Don't miss this. Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Let me convince you. I said, Jesus was led not by his flesh, not by God, but Jesus was led by the Spirit into the
anything else than the spirit, you need to change direction. In other words, you don't want to be led by your emotions, because your emotions will play tricks on you. You don't want to be led just by feelings alone, because you know your feelings are fickle. You don't want to be led simply by money or by fame, but you want to be led by the Spirit. I remember when the committee on ministry called me into a meeting up at Lancaster Theological Seminary in the library, and I walked in and I sat down and they started drilling me with questions. And then one of the questions said, well, why go to First Reform? Why don't you just go pass a Baptist church or another church? Why pass the First Reform? And I said, why not? I said, Bosch will teach you to put First Reform next to the courthouse, a place of judgment, and next in between the archbishop, a place of entertainment, because God knew that between judgment and entertainment, you would need some empowerment. I'm preaching it here. God knew that somewhere between judgment and entertainment, you needed some place to know that you are loved, regardless of who you love, of what you've done, who you've done it with, how long you've been doing it. That's why we're strategically placed here. It's not by accident that we've been here 287 years, because somebody needed the love. Somebody needed the light. Somebody needed the encouragement. And I love when I meet new members. They didn't read about us in the paper. They didn't see us online. But they said we were in Starbucks and the Spirit or something led us across the street. They said we were really Bill and Miss Bill. Bill said I was walking down the street and something called me to come into First Reform. I don't know what it is that brought you here. I don't know what it is that has kept you here. But my encouragement to you this morning is to don't give up. You got every reason, Kelly, to throw in the towel. You got every reason, Tara, to say it's over. You got every reason to say I don't want to keep going. But God wanted me to encourage somebody this morning and tell them don't give up. This is a good chance. This is a good place, I'm sorry, to look at that neighbor again. Matter of fact, look at somebody else and say, neighbor, don't give up. That was the wrong neighbor. You got to be scared to talk in church. Look at somebody else. Find them. Look at them eyeball to eyeball and say, neighbor, don't give up. Yes, it was at the very beginning of Jesus' public ministry that Jesus is led into the desert for an extended time of preparation. Don't miss that. Let me say it again. Jesus, beginning his public ministry, is led into the desert for an extended time of preparation. FRC, let me encourage you this morning that when you were going through without a pastor, when you were trying to decide how you were going to pay the bills, when you didn't even know if the lights were going to be on the next Sunday, that was your wilderness experiences. That was you being prepared. And I am of the persuasion that God is bringing FRC out of the wilderness. I am under the persuasion that we are inching our way closer and closer out of the wilderness and into a land that God has for us. Do I have a witness out there? All right, so here it is. Here it is. How did Jesus show us not to give up? I'm glad you asked. The first thing is look at the ways that Jesus was tempted. The first temptation was a physical temptation. Let the church say physical.
Physical.
Here it is, Jesus is hungry, 40 days, 40 nights, and notice what the tempter says. The tempter says, hey, if you are God's son, turn these stones to bread. The first temptation was a physical temptation. Say physical temptation. In other words, you have to understand that just because it feels right, I feel like we did. Just because it sounds right, just because it works somewhere else, doesn't mean it right for you. Just because someone else was able to do it doesn't mean that God has called you to do it. You have to know what's right for you. And what may be right for me may not be right for you. And what may be right for you may not be right for me. So you can't turn up your nose or act funny me because somebody doesn't have the same right as you. It's a physical temptation that we want to give up when things don't feel right. But the second temptation was an emotional temptation. Let the church say emotional. Emotional temptation. Here it is. He said, look.
Give up.
David, not Joshua, it's Jesus. And even Jesus who is in the wilderness, even Jesus who is famine and going through, refused to give up. So my encouragement to you, as you travel along, as you go through the rest of this year, don't give up, because if you still have a pulse, you still have a purpose.
Amen.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Y'all, because it's a
ticketed event, and we're going to get some tables and make sure we're there. They said they expect between 250 and 300 people. I said, all right, they're just glad to be in the number. So grateful that God has opened doors and opportunities. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's pray. God, we thank you that you reminded us this morning that you give us strength. And you gave Jesus in the wilderness to not give up. Somebody was ready to give up on a child. Somebody was ready to give up on a marriage. Somebody was ready to give up on a partner. Somebody was ready to give up on church. God, I thank you today that you encouraged us not to give up. That when we felt like throwing in the towel, help us, God, to hold on, as the song said, and take your hand. God, so many of our members are going through dealing with diagnoses of cancer, dealing with arthritis, dementia, Alzheimer's, God. Some are dealing with broken hearts, anxiety, depression. God, high blood pressure, diabetes. God, you know all about it. You know all of our diseases, and I pray that you would touch Darlene and Deb and Ron and Joanne and Kathy and Pat and Sue. God, touch Kay and Ron and Janet and Janine and Paula and Kathy and Ed and Bruce. God, continue to touch Alta and Dawn and Richard and Brian and Diane and Pedro and Los and Abby and Sean and Jackie. Touch Terry and Paul and Sabina and Ann and Carlene, Mary and Remley, the people of Ukraine, Russia, and Armenia. Touch Frank, touch Rick, touch Gordon, touch Glennis, touch Sharon, touch Shara, touch Amy, touch FRC, touch Pastor D, touch us, God. We pray the way you taught your disciples to pray. And say, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
40 East Lawn Street in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, that got your back. Let's pray for her, that our significant towards her. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray, God, that as Eileen traveled back to Puerto Rico, that she would give her traveling mercy. God, thank you for covering her from the crown of her head to the sole of her feet. God, I thank you that she goes back, God, that you would give her the skills and the emotions and everything that she needs to take care of her mother and her family. I thank you, God, that when she goes back, everything in her hand touches will be blessed. I thank you that her family will be blessed. I thank you that no sickness will touch her. I thank you even now, God, that she will keep in the reservoir of her mind a place called First Reform that gave her a job, that gave her love, and gave her ministry. We thank you for Eileen. We thank you for her in Jesus' name. And we thank you for being with her as she travels on. Amen and amen. Let's give her a round.
Have a blessed week.